rubidic test. In that region only, we have the Harappan sites in a large number. We do not have such a large number of sites in that of the period earlier than Harappans and also later than Harappans. So this is the region in fact which is very important. And Saraswati region, Saraswati River is frequently mentioned. And let me tell that now out of 2,000 sites, nearly 1,500 sites are located in the Saraswati basin itself. So that shows the significance of the Saraswati River. Harappans were not the only culture in fact, you know, flourished that time. You can see that entire Indian subcontinent was, you know, occupied. Outside the Harappan region, of course, there were ruler-based cultures, the early farming communities, all over in fact, you know, right from Bengal to, you know, South India to Tamil Nadu, and from Afghanistan to, you know, Kashmir. You know, we get, you know, these cultures. And let me tell you that the Harappans used to interact with all the people in fact, within South Asia also, and outside South Asia also. So even though the ancestry said, we do, you know, presume number of different groups within the Harappans, diversity within the Harappans, and also outside the Harappan region. And that diversity was used in fact by the Harappans, you know, very, you know, ingeniously for the development of the culture, for the development of the, you know, the their own traditions and culture there. So that is very important. Now this is now, I'll just show you a couple of slides indicating the beginning of the settled life, which is indigenous, just began. And then of course we can see the gradual development of stages. Now this is the site of Mehrgarh here. Now the deposit you are seeing that, you know, here, that is the deposit of the, you know, settlement of the habitation of the people at this particular spot at Mehrgarh. People have, you know, made occupation here for almost 6,000 years. So because of the, you know, occupation, continuous occupation at this particular spot, these type of mounds are formed, and we get different levels in that, and those different levels indicate different generations that live there. And here in fact, now because of such kind of sites, we are able to study the development. Jaris, in fact, Jaris who excavated the site. Now he has found out that, you know, when people came here, they just began the settled way of life. And these type of structures, very small flimsy structures were developed by these people, built by these people. This is how it began. And then gradually, every stage, seven different stages, eight different stages have been identified. And in each stage, we can see the emergence of the Harappan element and the development impact in the technology, in the material culture, refinements, you know, quite clear. So that is happening in fact now at the site. And in the, you know, second stage, the people have started, they introduced pottery. The pottery in the early stage is very handmade, crude. And then you can see gradual growth in the, you know, pottery technology also. And during the Harappan times, it becomes a classical, fast wheel-fed pottery, perfectly fired. So that is the growth, you know, we can see. That growth is visible, transformation is visible, both in fact in the structures as well as in the material culture. And we have studied, you know, in the, you know, architectural features and in the ceramic features, in fact, this particular growth. And that is a story with other material culture also, with other crafts also. So that is the development. And then, you know, the technology was fully developed. Why we call it the, you know, the middle phase of the Harappan as the mature phase? Because everything was mature, in fact. The technology was mature, the culture was mature. And, you know, they have reached the pinnacle, in fact, in that part. The evidence of the domestication, wheat and barley, the physical remains in fact, you can see, actual physical remains. And also the tools in fact, you know, sickle-like tools. Never before in fact we come across this type of tools, but these are the tools which are used for harvesting purpose. So develop the tools accordingly, and we have the evidence of that. So this is very, very important, you know, it shows the, you know, the beginning, you know, from the scratch in fact. And people have started, you know, experimenting, and they started, you know, the culture developing outside. Then the burial tradition. This is, of course, you know, the indigenous tradition. And from here, it continues, you know, up to Harappan times, beyond Harappan times. The Harappans and the early people probably had belief in life after death, belief in second life. and therefore they used to bury the dead or along the dead bodies with the pots which contain food and water. We know for sure because at Parmana, we have done the analysis, residue analysis, and we have proved that the Harappans were the pioneers in fact in developing Indian curry. That is the contribution of the Harappans. Chicken tandoor and Indian curry, that is the delicacies introduced by the Harappans, and we have established that. So probably the pots contain food and water. Then you can find the jewelry. Here you can see, in fact, the jewelry that you can see here. The raw material is not local, it is coming from outside. These are made of shell, and these type of shells are available only, you know, along the Karachi coast or the, you know, Gujarat coast near Dwarka. So probably, you know, this raw material has gone from a long distance. So that shows that right from the beginning, people have started developing this contact. Then coming to the river Saraswati, of course, you know, it is, you know, a lot of efforts have been made right from, you know British time or Dutch, you know, people also strive to understand the location of the Saraswati. And no doubt that, you know, right from the beginning, nobody raised a doubt about the location of the river Saraswati, because it is clearly mentioned that it originates from the Himalayas and how it flows. So that is clearly mentioned. On the basis of that, you know, the river is identified. And scientifically proved, ISRO in fact, you know, done the satellite photography imagery analysis, and they have shown the course, the dry course of the river. You can see here, right? This is the dry course of the river Saraswati. And when we study the settlement pattern of the Harappan settlements, we can see that, you know, the settlements are located in fact along the river banks on both the sides. So there is no doubt of that. So we have done that extensively. Then I come to the site of Rakhigarhi, a very important site. These are the, you know, the different mounds that have been identified by the Archaeologist of Survey of India. Then we have identified some more area, and today, you know, this is the largest Harappan city. We have done extensive mapping of the site. You can see the whole village is sitting on the most important part of the Harappan settlement at Rakhigarhi. And we are using, of course, some of the latest technologies like GPS survey, through which, you know, we can try to extract as much information as possible from the area which is under modern occupation. We know that, you know, we cannot really dislodge people. At the same time, we want to know about that part. So the latest technology, geophysical technology, is coming to our help. And we are doing a lot of work impacting that part also. And then you can see, maybe this is the aerial photograph of the site of Rakhigarhi. Nearly 10,000 people are living on the site. The citadel part, the most important part, is under the modern occupation. But at the same time, there is so much area available, in fact, nearly 50 to 60 hectare area available. And that area is enough, in fact, now which one can do the research work, in fact, at the site for next 200 years, that much area is available. So at least, now it is our responsibility to, you know, preserve this part of the site, which is so intact. Maybe in the next photograph you can see that. A beautiful, there is no scratch on the mound and so on. So the preserves is so good. So this is a part which is portrayed, of course, by the Archaeologist of India. But we have to make sure that, you know, that there is no encroachment happening, there is no destruction happening to the site. So we have to preserve our responsibility, and, you know, the villagers have taken the responsibility. And really I'm happy about that. Secondly, I just mentioned that, you know, we want to understand the journey from the formative stage up to the maybe the advanced stage, that is the urban stage of the Harappans. And here, in fact, in this particular section, nearly 24 meter deposit, which is the thickest deposit at any archaeological site. And here, in fact, in the deposit, you know, we can read the entire history of the Harappans, how they have evolved, how they began the lifestyle, how they evolved, and how they ultimately achieved that success, you know, which we see back in the middle of the 3rd millennium BC. In the early stage, at number of sites, including Rakhigarhi, we are getting the evidence of very modest structures, what we call the pig dwellings, circular pig dwellings. So that is the beginning, and in the next stage, of course, they started building foreground structures, from circular to rectangular or squarish. Then there is a development that the site becomes, you know, maybe bigger in some stage. Then there is a modicum of planning, and then there is a full-fledged town planning. So that gradual growth is very much visible, in fact, you know, at number of sites. This is the site of Vijnana, which was extended by the Archaeological Survey of India, which has produced very early days. And here also you can see, in the lowermost level there are peaks, and then of course, you know, you can see the rectangular structures and the introduction of typical Harappan building material like the bricks in proper ratio, 1:2:3 or 1:2:4. That was the ratio, you know, produced by the Harappans. And let me tell you that the Harappans were the best civil engineers, because these are the people who have taught the world the modern construction method, what we call today as English bond. Actually, the English bond method was not known to the Europeans or the English people until 1400 AD. But this is the earliest evidence of that. And today also, you know, the walls that we make of bricks, one line is placed horizontal, the next line is vertical. So that is the kind of, you know, method that was introduced by the Harappans, and it's still relevant in major part of the world. So we always say that it should be called as Harappan bond rather than English bond, because that is the contribution of the Harappans. So these are the peaks, you can say the small peaks, but you know, maybe 3 or 4 peaks, you know, contain one maybe cluster. And here of course you can say that one step, you know, peak is used for dwelling purpose, one for cooking purpose, one for storage. That is the type of, you know, function that we see. And in fact, in this speech also, you can see in-situ evidence of maybe plaster and the fireplace also. So no doubt that they look small, but these are the pieces, you know, which were actually used by people. So this is how the Harappans began their very modest lifestyle. And then of course in the next stage, now you can see how the growth is happening. This is the circular structure in the early stage. And you can see here, you know, number of floor levels. These are the floor levels of the rectangular structures. And then, of course, you know, these type of structures come in the beginning of the Harappan phase. And now you can see the typical Harappan elements associated with the structures, like the tandoor, which exactly looks like the modern tandoor, and the use of the bricks, even the concept of bathroom and toilet to come into existence. And then, of course, you know, the structures become bigger and bigger, and we can see the modicum of planning adopted by the Harappans. And here you can say this is the beginning of the mature Harappan phase. And you can see, you know, planning, you know, there's a street here, structures on both sides, a small street, small street. So that is the kind of planning, in fact, you know, comes into existence. And finally, we see this type of, you know, well-planned, very hygienic city. In fact, the Harappan city was so hygienic, very clean, because they have very efficient, you know, sanitary method, you know, developed by the Harappans. And I always, you know, always stress upon this fact that the modern town planners, in fact, they should study the Harappan town planning, and they can learn a lot, in fact. They can bring in a lot of features of the Harappans, which are so important, and so, you know, people friendly, in fact. Similar development is also noticed in Pune ceramic. This is the ceramic that we get, in fact, in the early levels of the Harappan people, Harappan culture. Slightly crude, handmade, hand model. And then gradually, of course, you know, these are, but at the same time, you can see the typical Harappan shapes introduced. And then, of course, in the later phase, of course, the pottery start becoming finer and finer. And then, of course, you know, we see the emergence of the classical Harappan pottery. So there is a evidence, you know, gradual development happening, and we have concrete evidence for that, and nobody can deny the presence of this type of evidence. Then I come to the most important part, the DNA study. As I said, that one of our aims of undertaking excavation at RakhiGarhi was to understand the people, the composition of the population, and their relation with the contemporary population. So we knew that, you know, unless we have the extraction of DNA, perhaps we would not be able to answer some of these important questions. And these questions are so important for the Indian history that we need to understand that. And because of, you know, not answering these questions scientifically, there is so much misunderstanding about Indian history. And our, you know, textbooks carry the same old story which was written by the Britishers long back. So the area of the cemetery, you can see here, quite big area. But I'm sure that the size of the settlement was so big that there may be number of cemeteries which we are not able to locate, because cemeteries are generally 1 kilometer away from the settlement, and a lot of cemeteries are in the, you know, in the modern fields. So probably, you know, because of the plowing, a lot of, you know, these cemeteries may have been destroyed. There's a possibility of maybe cremation method also followed by Harappans, for which of course we do not have any evidence, but that's also a possibility which we cannot rule out. The area that we excavated, and I am really grateful to the farmer who owns this land, so fortunately he allows us to carry out the work. And the lesson that we had learned from Parmana, we had not taken precaution like this in fact, you know, at Parmana for the excavation of the Koreans. When I came in contact with the Koreans, what we did in Parmana, of course, maybe we were excavating like as usual. A lot of people used to come and visit, and we opened all the barriers, 70 barriers at one and the same time, and we kept them open for almost 2 months. So there was, you know, rainfall, there was, you know, some strong sunshine. Because of this, you know, the fluctuation of the climate, probably the DNA slipped. And when we tried at the end, there's some Japanese scientists came, you know, the Korean scientists came, American scientists came. We miserably failed, you know, we did not get any use. And later, you know, in 2012 and 13, I came in contact with the Korean scientists. The Korean Seoul National University has a very fine department of forensic science, and there were some very good scientists that are working on this particular aspect. So they suggested that, you know, you extract one body at a time, immediately document it, and pack the samples for, you know, further sampling. So that is how we did, and before the excavation, you know, they say that you take proper precaution, because the modern DNA is so sensitive, it can get into the ancient DNA, and it will be very different. Now, of course, we can separate the modern DNA from the ancient DNA, because we have the technique now. But that time, when we started, that technique was not available, and there could be a lot of confusion. So they say that, you know, we have to take, you know, and we did that precaution, in fact, we use these gowns like, you know, the surgeons use, the masks, hand gloves, one separate, you know, maybe set of excursion instrument for one barrier. The same instruments were not used for the other barrier. So that type of precaution was taken. And all of the students, in fact, they have worked very, you know, extensively on, you know, these barriers. You know, we ourselves, in fact, have excursion barriers. And this turned out to be very, very successful exercise that ultimately. What we are doing also is, maybe next week, another paper is going to be published on in an international journal, in which we have shown the 3D reconstruction of the facial features of the Harappans. For the first time, we are going to show the world how the Harappan people are looking like exactly, the 3D image of that. And since, you know, now the paper is accepted, I can tell you that the Harappans and the modern Haryana people, they look exactly the same. Same height, same maybe, you know, the composition. Both, in fact, male and female, in fact, both are same. So that is, there is a continuity to that also. Not only the continuity of the ancestry, but also continuity in the, you know, the facial features and the morphology. So that is important, and also continuity in the multiculture. And we need this type of data for that, of course. We need characters like these for the reconstruction, you know, well preserved, all the features are visible, and then of course we need some very scientific, you know, CT scanning, etc. That data is very useful for the reconstruction purpose. So we did that, all this extensive, you know, test on these barriers. And finally, you know, because, you know, we have invested so much time in that, ultimately, let me tell you that it took us almost 12 to 13 years to get DNA from the Harappan skeletal remains. It is not as though that we started in 2013-14. We started long back. And after long struggle, in fact, we have finally succeeded, and then results are in front of you. So this is the, you know, the history of the DNA research that we have undertaken in India. You have, of course, this is one of the burials, the couple's burial found in the cemetery. And we have published some paper on this also, saying that the concept of husband and wife may have been initiated by the Harappans. Because here, you know, the male and female buried, you know, at the same, you know, in the same burial. We don't know the reason for the death because there is no injury marks. Probably, you know, one died because of some maybe heart failure or something, and the other died maybe because of shock. That is possibility. And they are buried with great honor in the common cemetery. That means, you know, the relationship between these two were acceptable to the society. Probably that means, you know, they were husband and wife. That is the, you know, our belief and the, you know, inference that we draw. So that, but since the Harappans have introduced a number of traditions which continue on today, this is a tradition which also may have continued from Harappan times to the modern times. Close up of that, very, you know, the number of burial goods vary from burial to burial, and from that we can make some inference about the social status, economic status of the family, of the person. So this is very important data that, you know, we have for understanding various features. Bone, you know, which is, you know, here, you know, it's called the petrous bone. Now that bone is considered the most potent for the preservation of the DNA. So we located this bone from, you know, different, all the, you know, all these kinds of remains that we excavated. They were examined properly. We got very faint DNA from four skeletal remains, and we thought that is not really, you know, good enough to make any conclusion. So we were about to, you know, drop this project. And then lastly, in fact, then we found the burial, you know, the strong DNA from one skeletal remain. And that has turned, you know, the history impact here for us. So the, you know, way we have, you know, proceeded, how scientific, you know, the procedure that we have done. So we have done the anthropological examinations. We have published this anthropological examination, in fact, in PLOS one of the prestigious journals. Then, of course, I will show you that the CT scan data was created for the reconstruction of the facial feature. Then, paleoparasitology, which is very important. And then, of course, we have done a lot of other studies, like, you know, we have done the pathological studies on the, you know, on the Harappan skeletal remains. And we also done the, you know, stable isotope analysis by which we can understand what type of food habits the Harappans had, what is the percentage of plant food, what is the percentage of animal food in the diet, that could be also found out. And the pathology part was done by the Korean scientists. And ultimately, at the end of the study, they were so disappointed. They said that, no, we don't see any disease impacting Harappan people. They were so healthy, and that was possible because of the, you know, very clean and hygienic city that the Harappans developed. So we have that habit, in fact. It is all in our blood, in fact, to keep our, you know, cities clean. But unfortunately, because of the various problems, you know, we are not recovering today. And this is that lady, the lady left for us, which has provided the strong DNA. from the, we have done a lot of taking on these. It is dated to almost 2400 BC. And also the associated material, typical Harappan pottery of the middle phase. So it is dated to around 2400 BC. And this lady is, you know, aged between 35 to 40 years. So, you know, what we've done in fact, we have extracted DNA from this particular lady, we have analyzed that, we have sequenced that, and then now we compare that data with the contemporary population from Iran, the site called Shari Sokta, Iran. It is located here, Shari Sokta. You know, maybe 8 skeletal remains from Shari Sokta were examined. And what we found, which is very important, that in the Shari Sokta skeletal remain, we found the Harappan gene there, in that particular skeletal remain. Along with that, we have some Harappan material. That means, you know, and we do not have the Harappan gene, in fact, present in fact in the Harappan population at all. So that means the Harappans have started going there. It is not that, you know, they were coming in the first year, but Harappans have started going there. And then, of course, there is a, you know, mutual movement of the people happening. But it has initiated by the Harappans, and that is really impact from this particular analysis compared to study. And also, we, you know, studied the site of Golu in Turkmenistan. Professor Bibinal, in fact, has studied material from this particular site, and he has reported a lot of Harappan goods at this particular site. And in the skeletal remains, you know, 3 skeletal remains were studied from that particular site. And in that, we have found again the Harappan gene present in the, you know, burial in the skeletal remains of the 3 skeletal remains that we excavated, plus the Harappan material. So it is out of India theory, you know, that is getting support from this particular data. So that was one part which we did. And second, you know, we have a lot of data of the modern people. Nearly 3,000 modern samples were compared. And we have chosen all the different groups that are available, 150 different groups available in fact in South Asia. So their, you know, data was, you know, the DNA was, you know, compared with the Harappans. And surprisingly, we found Harappan elements continuing in the gene, in the ancestry of the South Asian people. That is very important. So there is a continuity. So that demolishes the, you know, the Aryan, you know, invasion of migration theory, because if the Aryans had come from outside, they would have dislodged the population there and they would have started new ancestry, which is not happening. People were coming and going, of course. The Huns came here, the Kushans came, but you know, the local population was not really in place. We find groups, in fact, here and there. But that is important that, you know, that was happening. And, you know, we are getting evidence for that. And secondly, you know, from Bengal to Afghanistan, which was made by the British historians during the Harappan times, all the people of different religions, different, you know, maybe groups, different, following different castes or, you know, religion, all of them have the common ancestry. So this is important. And as Harappans have used this diversity for the development, you know, we should use that diversity for our development. This is a lesson that we learned from history, and that is an important lesson from this particular woman, in fact, you know, which we have got. And then I will tell you about the evidence, very briefly I think, that indicates that the Vedic people are the Harappans. Because the Vedic text in fact is mentioned that, you know, the area that was occupied by the, you know, Indo-Aryan people, surface in the area. And in this area only we get the Harappan settlements. With the text of mention about in the Drushyabhis Valley, and then, you know, we have Kaliganga, Parmana, Banavali, and, you know, some more sites. So it, and there are no cities of the later period in fact in this region. So if at all the Vedic texts are mentioned about the, you know, cities and towns, they have referred to the Harappan because they were the actual settlements which are present there. So that is possibility. The Rupertic text has mentioned frequently about the river Saraswati and the flourishing cities and the towns. So probably the actual what they have seen in fact was written by the people, and probably they have seen the Harappan settlement there, and they have written about the Harappan people there. Then the Rigvedic text talks about maybe the 45 cities, and most of the Harappan cities are fortified, very strongly fortified. So this is the reconstruction of the city of Harappa, done by the American scholars Richard Meadow and Mark Kenoy. So very well, 45 cities, we have evidence of that. Then also the Vedic text talks about the ideal city divided into three parts. And the only evidence of its kind comes from the city of Dholayuda. We do not have this type of partition of the later cities till modern times. So if at all they have mentioned, they must have mentioned about the city of Dholayuda. And here you can see the Acropolis, Little Town, and the Lower Town. These are the three divisions, and each division was highly fortified. That is the kind of evidence in the way of hitting. And you can see the nature of the fortification here. A very strong, almost 18 meter thick fortification wall. So that is the wall for the citadel part. Then we also have the same fortification, slightly thinner fortification for the middle town and also for the outer town. So that is the correspondent evidence, in fact, is found in fact in the actual data. That is very important, and therefore we suggest that the Rigvedic text has mentioned about these cities only, Harappan cities, not of any kind, but of the earlier cities. And of course, the perfect planning, which is also mentioned, can see in fact the main streets running perfectly in perpendicular angle, north, south, and eastern directions, structures located. So that is the kind of intention of everything. Secondly, there is mention about the fire worship. The sacrificial altars, the platforms, and the fire worship mentioned by the Rigvedic text. And only the sites located in the Saraswati basin has this particular evidence. We do not have this kind of evidence in Gujarat, nor in Sindh, nor in Punjab part of Pakistan. It is only located in this part. And here you can see the platform, sacrificial platform on which we have a number of small altars. And these are the, it mentions about the different kinds of altars, in fact, the yoni shape, human shape, and we have the interspawned from the Harappan sites, dated to around 2400 BC, 2500 BC. And this is a very important evidence. You can see here, in fact, the American scholar, particularly Kenoy, thinks that these are the trash feet. But nobody built brick-lined trash feet. On the other hand, we have in-situ evidence of the burnt wood and also the animal bones inside. So this is definite evidence about the fire worship, fire sacrificial altars by the Harappan people. There is also mention about the different kinds of burial system, and we have found that usually buried in north-south direction, that is mentioned. We are getting that evidence. We are getting up different kinds of burials now, maybe primary burials, secondary burials, symbolic burials, that is the evidence mentioned. And we have that evidence in part from the Harappan sites in this part. Also, the Harappans were now, the Vedic people were seafaring people, and Harappans are pioneering that. The Lothal was the earliest dockyard in the world, dockyard come port. So we are the pioneers, in fact. And the type of ships that the Harappans have developed, in fact, two type of ships have been mentioned. The flying ship with flat bottom, even today, this type of ships are flying, in fact, in the Indus River. And the other one is the boat made of reed, the thick grass. And in fact, you can see, in fact, both these boats, the modern boats, you can see a house inside. That means that these boats were flying in a deep sea on long distance. And there are some birds also. Birds are required if you are flying in long distance in sea, because they are the ones who can locate the land nearby. So that is the kind of evidence we are getting. So it is all supporting, in fact. People, they mention about the meditation system, the yoga system mentioned by the Harappans, and we have the evidence of that. So that is the tradition, and we are actually, this is the early form of Shiva called Pashupati. And you can see these are the terracotta figurines from the Harappan sites, showing in different postures of yoga. And that is the intense impact. Yoga science is considered the best gift of India to the world. And the tradition starts in fact during the Harappan times. The worship of Shiva, there is a criticism that we do not have Vaidic gods in the Harappan levels. But Vaidic gods are in fact, they were perhaps not worshipped in the form of anthropomorphic form probably because Varun cannot be worshipped in an anthropomorphic form. So they must have done the nature worship and therefore they are not getting it. But usually it is believed that the Shiva worship is Shiva is a god of non-Aryan people. But let me tell you that Shiva worship is more common in fact in North India, right from maybe Himalayas, down south of Tuma, Rameshwar. We have people are following this. So I believe that this was the universal god in fact in South Asia, worshipped by the entire population. And we have the representation of that. We do not have there's a debate on the horse. Let me tell you again that yesterday we had a presentation by one of our scientists. And he has established that there are a number of Harappan sites which have produced the bones of the domesticated horse and also of the donkey also, wild donkey. So horse was very much there. There is a site called Surkotara. And the bones from the site were studied in Kutch part of Gujarat. And they were studied by two different groups of specialists. One headed by one Bokoni from Hungary, who was the very, very known archaeozoologist. And he has established that there is a horse present in fact in the Harappan level. And the same bones were studied later by a group from Harvard University, Richard Meadow and his students. And they said that maybe no, these are not the bones of the domestic horse, they are the bones of wild donkey. So there's a debate, but more and more sites, So that is, that evidence is very much there. Now this is the evidence used. The skeletal remains lying in the street at Mohenjo-daro in the upper part. Sir Mortimer Wheeler was of the strong opinion that these are the people who were killed by the Aryans. And he thought that the Harappans are Dravidians. The Aryans came from outside and they destroyed, they killed the entire Harappan civilization, they destroyed the civilization. And this is the evidence that he used. He said these are the people who were killed. But later, all these skeletal remains were studied scientifically by physical anthropologists. A very famous physical anthropologist called Kenneth Kennedy from America. And he did not find any evidence of injury marks on the bones of these skeletal remains. His hypothesis was that perhaps these people died either in some kind of epidemic or they died because of the flood. And Indus River has the history of floods in fact. The site was destroyed, the city was destroyed two times when the economy was booming, so they could reconstruct that. And the last time it happened that when the decline started, and that time probably these people died in fact in the flood. And then after the decline, we know that climate was very, very important. It has played an important role in the decline. And after the decline, the peoples deserted the two important basins, the Indus Basin and the Sarasvati. Of course, it was gradual desertion of this of this area. And they started moving the peripheral area. A lot of people went to UP. Some group of people came to maybe Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, South India also. And they got mixed because those areas were already occupied by the contemporary, early farming communities. So they got mixed up with the early farming communities and they kept alive the tradition there. So this is how the dispersion of the Harappans started. And as I mentioned that the Harappans, they were so advanced that they could have introduced the early form of Sanskrit. The language, because they needed the language. We do not know about the script, but they needed the language. And in the area where we find the Harappan influence, there only we find the the Indo-European language spoken in fact in the Indian subcontinent. So it is quite likely that they invented this particular early form of Sanskrit, and that was maybe the mother of the Indo-European language. That is, we do not have evidence, but that is our case. And even Sir William Jones, in fact, who started the Ascetic Society. He also mentioned that there are a lot of Sanskrit words, in fact, in Latin and in Greek. So probably, because these languages could have been, you know, derived from Sanskrit, we find a lot of common words. That is our hypothesis, of course. And then, of course, now after the decline of the cities, again they reverted back to the rural life, the village-based life, and we are taking the evidence of that, in fact. So finally, of course, now the conclusions are, you know, you can read that no migration happening for last 20,000 years, but the movement is happening, interaction was happening, that is true. There was, you know, maybe different diverse groups, but all of them had the common ancestry. And then, of course, so we can relate, you know, the rubric, you know, textual evidence to the architectural evidence. And this is changing the perspective of the Indian history. So even today, in fact, we are teaching the Aryans, about the Aryans who came from outside, they killed the local people here, they pushed the Dravidians to South India, etc. But that is all fabricated story, has no substantial evidence. The evidence that we have speaks about a different story altogether. And that, according to us, is the true history and the most scientific data that we have created in this particular history. Thank you very much.
आपने आर्यन स्टोरी पर एक गहन चित्र प्रस्तुत किया है. आशा है आपके द्वारा किया गया शोध वैज्ञानिक संबंध में विराजमान बहुत सी अनिश्चितताओं को दूर करेगा. अब हम शंका निवारण के लिए कुछ प्रश्नों को ले पाए, क्योंकि समयाभाव है तो उसके कारण अधिक प्रश्न को ले पाना कठिन है.
Your best to populate because you can see the structures very closely, you know, located to each other. And you know, very dense, you know, city impact in every past year, country. But then other big cities like RakhiGarhi, because the area was a lot of available, people had the scope of expanding the settlements. But it, you know, it appeared that, you know, that the population was quite dense in the happy times. Sir.
Hello sir, I'm actually, like you were talking about urban planning, I'm an urban planner myself. So I have just four questions to you. Like, we have been studying that the reason of decline for any city or town in the ancient time has been hygiene and flooding, of course. Mm-hmm. So when you mentioned about the fortification of these cities, which definitely can be seen in all the urban cities, have you ever discovered structures and mechanisms which have prevented this flooding issue?
Yes.
Just moist and stuff like that.
In fact, at the site of Bhulaya, that is a classical site, they have made a proper arrangement for the storm water, these drainage systems. Also, the underground water channel system that they created, they have at regular intervals, there are air ducts provided so that no one can go down and clean them. So the most modern system was introduced by the Harappans, and that is very much visible.
And did you find any gradient which nowadays civil engineers, sorry to say?
Yes, at most of the sites, at most of the cities, see, they have introduced the toilets and bathrooms, which is why it's quite clean. But probably they were the first people in the world to do that. And we have two separate lines of drainage, where the closed drainage for toilet and the open drainage for the toilet, for the bathroom. So they had the network of that within the city, and it was connected to the main drainage line, which was taken outside the city wall and empty somewhere, making sure that no dirty water spreads within that place. That's how, you know, they have maintained. So it's very simple, very effective method, which can be learned in fact easily. So that is what, you know, I was thinking, in fact, that, you know, these are the simple techniques which can be used even today. The water harvesting method, in fact, water management, water engineering method that they devised at the site of Dholavina. If we replicate that, which does not really require foreign funding, foreign collaboration, very simple, the community can develop that. If that is applied, in fact, in the Kutch part of Gujarat, I tell you, the entire country is green land. So this is something that we can learn from the Harappans, and we can really replicate, which is so relevant today.
क्वेश्चन एक आग्रह है कि जो अपना नाम और किस इंस्टीट्यूट से संबद्ध है वो लोग चाय के समय डिस्कस कर सकते हैं क्योंकि बहुत से और लोग भी हैं और समय अभाव है तो आपसे प्रार्थना है बाद में ले सकते हैं
सर हेलो सर I have two questions. My first question is, despite a few cultural traits, what are the other major characteristics of the Indus Valley could continue after its demise? I mean, why it took another 1,000 years to occur the next urbanization?
See, there are various reasons. In fact, climate, as I mentioned, that was the most important part. After 2000 BC, we have data on the climatic condition. So from 2000 BC, almost up to 39 BC, we do not have the good climate. In fact, it became more dry, and it was not possible for the people, in fact, to build cities and towns. They could manage, in fact, in the villages only. And then, you know, this knowledge was kept alive. You know, when the conditions became ripe for the urbanization, that urbanization, second urbanization, you know, happened immediately because the knowledge was very much there. But because of maybe the climatic condition, because of maybe various other reasons that, you know, probably, you know, the people had to desert the cities and towns, and they began to live in fact in the city, in the villages. But we are working on this, you know, what are the other issues? Social issues, economic issues, which may be responsible for the decline. But we do not have sufficient, you know, the answer at this particular stage.
Depending upon the geographical factors,
environmental factor, the food habit of the people, because of that, you know, various reasons, in fact, the morphology changes, in fact, from region to region. And people in North India, in fact, you know, they have got the short features. And it kind of remains that we are studying. The woman was so beautiful there, because she has such a sharp features. So they are like, you know, the modern people, in fact. So that is happening, in fact, right from the beginning. And even today, we are experiencing that. And then, you know, later part, you know, these, you know, people from maybe other parts will come in and get mixed up with the Harappans and with the population here. And the influence of more, in fact, in North India, because that is close to Iran, close to Central Asia. Because of that, we find more, in fact, you know, this impact on the population of the northern part compared to the South India.
Pallav Bhavna, I am a science journalist. Shinde ji, a very fantastic presentation by you. One, I don't know whether we have the evidence, but is there any evidence to show that RakhiGarhi is older than Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, or what is the timeline?
Yes. We have, in fact, you know, we have at least half a dozen sites now in the Saraswati Basin. When, you know, we got early days from the site of Virana, everybody, you know, made they were suspicious about the date because they think that, you know, we have only one site, you know, from where we are on the date. It's a possibility that, you know, these dates are contaminated. So we did not react to that immediately. Then we started generating data from other sites. Then I excavated, you know, the site of Viravar, where we found the early dates like 6000 BC. Mitathal has also early dates like, you know, 5500 BC. Parmana has early dates and Rakhiri. So now the dates that we have from this part of the Saraswati Basin are older than the dates, you know, we have from the Indus Basin. But I don't, you know, claim that, you know, the origin took place here and people start moving. There may be some sites in that part also which have not been, you know, yet been tapped or excavated. There may be some older sites in that part also. So it will be, you know, hasty to make any statement about the movement. But at this stage, we have already early dates for the beginning of the Harappan culture from this region at least. I will not, you know, buy the theory. In the Saraswati, you know, that is fine name, that because it represents the Harappan culture properly. So that is what, you know, we are using now in the Saraswati. See, Saraswati has to come because now 2/3 of the Harappan settlements are located in Saraswati Basin. So that is the hub of the Harappans, in fact. Very important region for the Harappans. So we cannot really neglect that. So somewhere it should be taken. I am against, you know, coining different terms because now the students get too confused. We have Harappan civilization, Indus Valley civilization, Indus Saraswati civilization. The students will get confused whether we are talking for the same culture or these are the different cultures. So to avoid that, you know, maybe we should adopt one term in India. And then, you know, there's a need to have some kind of agreement among the scholars in India, and we should devise a term, either we call it Harappan civilization, because that is a tradition that in archaeology, that you name the culture where the culture is identified, from the place where the culture is identified. So we are finding there either Harappan civilization or the Harappan Indus Saraswati civilization, but not the Indus Valley civilization, because that only represents the, you know, Indus region. That was not the case. So we need to really discuss on this particular issue.
Yes. Sir, I'm Rupesh Chaturvedi from JV. Sir, about paleobacteriology, did they look at for the evidence for bacteria and viruses too? In a paleobacteriology, did they look for the evidence for bacteria?
Yeah, we have done that extensively. The Korean scientists, you know, they were doing this particular research. But we have not really found anything impact in that. And bacteria is very important because from bacteria also you can get some clue. But unfortunately it was not surviving there. So.
You know, one bacteria which is found in our population, which is Helicobacter pylori, there are some studies where they have shown that they have traced the migration, how H. pylori and mixing has happened.
That is possible.
But I think you are looking at the bacteria could be useful because it captures a very short span of time. Instead of DNA mixing in a human, which could take some longer.
Yeah, of course, this is the beginning of our research and we have future plan, of course. We want to have generate more data, of course. So the data that we have is very small at this stage. And our plan is that we generate more data, not only from one region, in fact, because the Harappan were in different ecological zones. So we have to have data from all the different ecological zones. Then only perhaps we will be able to talk about the composition, about the movement of the people. And then, of course, we have the data from the continental population outside the Harappan region also, so that, you know, we can talk about the relation between this continental population and the Harappan. And also from Harappan to maybe, you know, the Chalkoli to the Iron Age. So that data also needs to be produced. So we have a very big plan, in fact, or maybe, you know, we'll be requesting, you know, people like JNT to take this, you know, issue to the government so that we should have one institute dedicated for this particular study, particular research. And that is the need of the hour, because for India, that is really important. See, for this particular sample, we have spent 5 crores for analyzing this particular sample. So you can imagine how expensive it is. Not possible to do for every site. But if you have some dedicated institute for this, where the scientists can, and the archaeologists and historians can come together and work on the common issue, so that is now possible. We can also work on the Harappan script also, because at this stage we do not know what is the, you know, Harappan script. So linguists, people should come together, sociologists, anthropologists, you know, historians, archaeologists, they should come together and work on the common issue. So now, you know, we have identified this, these issues in fact in Harappan archaeology, in Indian archaeology, and we have to now proceed according to the plan in fact that we have in our mind.
Now, since time
is up, okay. Yeah, there is a question. Okay. I would like to do this question in Hindi. I think
you will
understand the question. Yes, yes. The place that you have mentioned, RakhiGarhi, उससे पहले मैं अपना नाम बता दूं, मेरा नाम योगेश है, मैं राखीगढ़ी के 15 किलोमीटर दूर का ही रहने वाला, बचपन बीता है। भाई आपकी जितनी ये प्रोसीडिंग्स हुई है, इसके बाद कल जाने का वहां पर अवसर मिला, वजीर सिंह सरोहा करके एक व्यक्ति से वहां मिलना हुआ, जिस प्रकार के सांस्कृतिक आघात से हम रोजाना जूझते हैं, ऐसा ही प्रश्न कल सरोहा जी ने खड़ा किया। आपके माध्यम से जानना चाहूंगा, उन्होंने प्रश्न किया कि ये जितनी प्रोसीडिंग्स यहाँ चल रही हैं, जितनी प्रकार की खोज चल रही हैं, ये आर्यन वैज्ञानिक आकर सिद्ध करना चाह रहे हैं, वास्तव में मूल निवासी को यहाँ से खदेड़ दिया गया था, और उसका प्रमाण ये है कि मूल निवासी के जो गॉड हैं, वो उनके हाथ में कोई हथियार नहीं है, और आर्यंस के जो गॉड हैं उनके हाथ में हथियार हैं और ये सब थ्योरी यहाँ पर जबरदस्ती प्रतिपादित की जा रही है। इसके बारे में आपकी साइंटिफिक जो भी ये सारी आप सबने खोज की है मिलकर साधुवाद देते हुए, इसके बारे में जानना चाहूंगा कि इस प्रकार के जो आघात किए जा रहे हैं इसका काउंटर हम जैसे लोग किस प्रकार से कर सकते हैं वैज्ञानिक तर्कों के आधार।
हम जो जनरेट कर रहे हैं उसके बारे में बात किया गया कि उनका विकास कैसे, शुरुआत कैसे हुई और विकास कैसे होते गया उसके बारे में हमने जिक्र किया। तो इसका मतलब यह है कि यहाँ के लोगों ने शुरुआत की, इसका साइंटिफिक रिजल्ट मिल रहा है। अभी वजन सिंह का जो अनसाइंटिफिक थिंकिंग है उसको अगर सपोर्ट नहीं है तो हम एक्सेप्ट नहीं कर सकते, ये सपोर्ट है उसके लिए। और यहाँ दो प्रकार के सोर्सेस है, एक तो आर्कियोलॉजिकल सोर्सेस है हमारे पास बहुत स्ट्रॉन्ग और हमें पता है कि कैसे वो विकास के अलग अलग जो स्टेजेस है वो कैसे थे वो हमें पता है। दूसरे कि अभी साइंटिफिक जो डीएनए का जो रिजल्ट बाहर आ रहा है बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट है कि 12,000 साल से हमारे एंसेस्ट्री चेंज नहीं हुई। हंटिंग गैदरिंग स्टेज में क्या था वो अलग बात है, कोई उसके बारे में हमको जानकारी नहीं, लेकिन जब से हमने एग्रीकल्चर शुरुआत की, डोमेस्टिक की शुरुआत की, तब से अभी तक लोगों में कोई चेंज नहीं आया, लोगों के एंसेस्ट्री में कोई चेंज नहीं आया। लोग आते बाहर से, लोग आते गए, यहाँ से बाहर गए और मिक्सिंग अप होते गया, लेकिन वो चेंज नहीं हुआ। ये साइंटिफिक हमको हमको एविडेंस मिल रहा है, इसके अलावा एविडेंस क्या चाहिए कि जो हम उसको शिफ्ट कर सके।
अब हम आज के कार्यक्रम के अध्यक्ष समुद्र विज्ञान संस्थान गोवा के निदेशक रहे हैं तथा वर्तमान समय में विज्ञान भारती से जुड़े हैं और मेरठ प्रांत के उपाध्यक्ष हैं। आपसे निवेदन है सर, आपके अध्यक्ष जी उद्बोधन
ज़्यादा समय नहीं लूँगा, समय की वैसे ही कमी है। मैं ना ही आर्कियोलॉजिस्ट हूँ और ना ही मॉलिक्यूलर बायोलॉजिस्ट, आई एम ओनली स्टैंडिंग इन फॉर माय डीजी एंड आई एम गोइंग जस्ट टॉक अबाउट कपल ऑफ ड्राइवर्स ऑफ दीज चेंजेस दैट वर एक्चुअली अल्यूडेड टू इन टुडेज लेक्चर। वन इज द क्लाइमेट चेंज विच वी स्पोक अबाउट, मेनी ऑफ दीज माइग्रेशंस और डिसअपीयरेंस ऑफ सिविलाइजेशंस are intimately linked to climate change as a topic of recent research. The other thing that was not mentioned, and you know, I being an oceanographer, I am being in touch, is the changes in sea level. The sea level has been going up and down, not only in the US static sense, absolute sense, but also because of the movement of continents because of tectonic activities. So a large parts of what we know our coastal areas were actually exposed 20,000 years ago at the height of the last glacial maximum. The sea level was 120 meters below what it is today. So if you were to go to Mumbai, for example, and look out, the sea at that time, 20,000 years ago, was 75 kilometers away. Okay? And the entire shelf was exposed. And the time frame that Vasanji was talking about, I mean, that was the time frame in which where people were actually living on the shelf, you know, close to, you know, many of these habitation centers. What I want to tell you is that there is a wealth of information buried underwater. And my institute has been, the institute that I have been associated for a very long time, has been working on these aspects for a while. You might have heard about Dwarka, where one of my colleagues, Dr. CSIR Rao, who came from Archaeological Survey of India, did a lot of excavation. And we found submerged structures of Dwarka. My colleague, Rajiv Nigam, also worked of Tamil Nadu coast. I think there's a great deal of information which is submerged. And that is also something that we should be looking at. With these few words, because we are short of time, I would like to thank on behalf of CSIR all of you for having come here, and of course Sanjeev for such an absorbing and wonderful talk. Thank you very much.
कार्यक्रम के अंतिम पड़ाव की ओर अग्रसर हैं। मैं डॉक्टर ओमकार राय जी से निवेदन करता हूं कि धन्यवाद ज्ञापन प्रस्तुत करें। इससे पहले उनका एक संक्षिप्त परिचय देना चाहूंगा। डॉक्टर ओमकार राय सॉफ्टवेयर प्रौद्योगिकी पार्क के महानिदेशक हैं, वैज्ञानिक विज्ञान भारती के अध्यक्ष हैं। आप इससे पहले राष्ट्रीय सूचना विज्ञान केंद्र NIC में कार्यरत रहे हैं। वर्तमान में आप AIC STP आई नेक्स्ट इनिशिएटिव के अध्यक्ष हैं। आप इंटरनेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी भुवनेश्वर के बोर्ड ऑफ गवर्नर्स के सदस्य हैं। आपने स्नातक परास्नातक की उपाधि व शोध कार्य बनारस हिंदू विश्वविद्यालय से किया है।
इस महत्वपूर्ण व्याख्यान में इस कार्यक्रम के मुख्य अतिथि माननीय श्री जयंत जी सदस्य थे, इस कार्यक्रम के मुख्य वक्ता प्रोफेसर वसंत शिंदे जी, इस कार्यक्रम के अध्यक्षता कर रहे श्री डॉक्टर शसरबुधे नकवी जी, हमारे सहयोगी श्री सुमित मिश्रा जी, इस कार्यक्रम में पधारे बहनों और भाइयों, मुझे धन्यवाद ज्ञापन करने के लिए कहा गया है, समय बहुत कम है और मैं सबसे पहले इस कार्यक्रम के मुख्य अतिथि माननीय जयंत जी शसरबुधे का धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा, जो पूरे वर्ष प्रवास पर रहते हैं, लगातार व्यस्त रहते हैं, उसके बावजूद नए नए कार्यक्रमों से हम लोगों को परिचित कराते रहते हैं। यह कार्यक्रम भी उनकी प्रेरणा से हुआ, मैं आप सबकी तरफ से अपनी तरफ से उनको धन्यवाद देता हूँ। इस कार्यक्रम में हम सब ने प्रोफेसर वसंत शिंदे जी को सुना, इस कार्यक्रम के पहले भी अखबारों के माध्यम से हम इस विषय के बारे में परिचित हो चुके हैं। वैसे तो हम सब इस विषय की जो गुरु होता है और जो इस विषय में वामपंथी इतिहासकार ब्रिटिश इतिहासकार जो एक दुष्प्रचार कर रहे थे, आज उसका वैज्ञानिक सिद्धांतों और परीक्षणों के आधार पर हम उस पूरे सिद्धांत का खंडन कर पा रहे हैं और हम गर्व से कह पा रहे हैं कि हमारी एंसेस्ट्री हमारे पूर्व के भारतीय थे और वही थे। ये बहुत बड़ा विषय था और इस विषय को एक वैज्ञानिक तथ्य पर वैज्ञानिक परीक्षण पर विराम दे पाए हैं, तो उस वसंत शिंदे जी को हम हृदय से आभार व्यक्त करते हैं। श्री डॉक्टर एस डब्ल्यू एस नकवी जी ने इस कार्यक्रम की अध्यक्षता की और उन्होंने एक नया आयाम दिया कि जो बहुत सारा वेल्थ ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन है वो समुद्र में दबी हुई है, उसको भी हम उसका भी परीक्षण करें। इस कार्यक्रम में आए हुए मैं कुछ लोगों को भी धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा, विशेषकर आप सबको मैं धन्यवाद देता हूँ। लेकिन इस कार्यक्रम में श्री संजीव शानदार जो नोटेड इकोनॉमिस्ट हैं, नॉलेजिस्ट हैं और भारत सरकार में मिनिस्टर फाइनेंस में फाइनेंशियल एडवाइजर भारत सरकार के ब्रिगेडियर पक्षी जी हैं, हम सब उनको रोज टीवी पे देखते हैं। डॉक्टर टी के अस्पताल जी, दिनेश अग्रवाल जी, अंजना अग्रवाल जी, मनोज पटेलिया जी, दीपक बागला जी, आप सबको मैं हृदय से धन्यवाद देता हूँ, आभार स्वागत करता हूँ। विज्ञान भारती तरफ से मैं एक और आपको संदेश देना चाहूँगा कि जो डॉक्टर शेखर मांडे जी टी जी सी एस आई आर और सेक्रेटरी टी एस आई आर जो इस कार्यक्रम की अध्यक्षता करने वाले थे, उनको बुखार हो गया था, ज्वर हो गया था और उन्होंने इसी कारण से वो इस कार्यक्रम में नहीं आ पाए, लेकिन उन्होंने आप सबको अपना अभिवादन दिया, आप सबको कहा है कि आपके लिए तरफ से आप सबको नमस्कार है, मैं अपनी तरफ से उनकी तरफ से भी आपको नमस्कार करता हूँ, आभार।